Johnny.
I love Corina, tell the world I do. I love Corina, tell the world I do. Just a little more loving, let your heart be true.
Corina, Corina, why it's been so long? Corina, Corina, where you been so long? I ain't had no loving since you been gone.
I left Corina far across the sea. I left Corina far across the sea. Wouldn't write me no letters, she didn't care for me.
Corina, Corina, where you been so long? Corina, Corina, where you been so long? Ain't had no loving since you've been gone.
Day last night, came home this morning, sun shining bright.
Corina, Corina, where you been so long? Corina, Corina, where you been so long? Ain't had no loving since you've been gone.
Mr. Willie Nelson, Corina, Corina. He'll be back and do another one for you just a moment.
He looked down into her brown eyes and said, say a prayer for me. And she threw her arms around him and said, God will keep us free. They could hear the riders coming. He said, this is my last fight. If they take me back to Texas, they won't take me back alive. There were 7 Spanish angels at the altar of the sun. They were praying for the lovers in the valley of the guns. And when the battle stopped, there was thunder from the throne, and 7 Spanish angels took another angel home. She reached down and picked the gun up that lay smoking in his hand. She said, Father, please forgive me, I can't make it without my man. She knew the gun was empty, and she knew she could not win. But her final prayer was answered, when the rifles fired again. There were seven Spanish angels at the altar of the sun. They were praying for the lovers in the valley of the gun. And when the battle stopped and the smoke cleared, there was thunder from the throne. And seven Spanish angels took another angel home. There were seven Spanish angels at the altar of the sun. They were praying for the lovers in the valley of the guns. And when the battle stopped and the smoke cleared, there was thunder from the throne. And seven Spanish angels took another angel home.
We'll come in with a word here from Bertha's Kitty Boutique for persons who care about cats, and a little song for the cats. Mr. Willie Nelson and Mr. Julio Gimble.
All the cats I've known before who wanted to come in my door, and then they turned around and wanted to go out so they could come back in once more.
To all you cats I once caressed and scratched them up and down the nest, then I screamed because I felt a set of claws start marching up my naked chest.
Two men sitting late at night having a beer and reminiscing about their cats. And why not? Cats are such an important part of our lives, the good times, the bad times too. Maybe it's time you make sure to remember with a color cat portrait from Bertha's for the special pet you just can't forget.
To all the cats who shed their hair and tripped me as I went downstairs and left a you-know-what lying on the rug, scratched up all my easy chair.
To all the cats I've ever known, I hope you find another home. If you think you might, come see me, I'm all right. I think I'd rather be alone. To all the cats I've known before.
Bertha's Kitty Boutique in the Dales, Royal del Clyde, del Air del Pico, Chippendomondo, and all the other fine shopping.
When you find another's arms around you, do you ever think of me? And when you whisper, I can't live without you, do you ever think of me? And in your eyes disguised with same old loving lies, you tell so tenderly. And in your heart I'm feeling, when some heart you're stealing, do you ever think of me? Thank you. mother's arms around you, do you ever think of me? And when you whisper, I can't live without you, do you ever think of me? And in your eyes disguise those same old loving lies you told so tenderly. And in your heart I'm feeling, when some heart you're stealing, do you ever think of me? Crazy for feeling so lonely, and I'm crazy, crazy for feeling so blue. I knew you loved me as long as you wanted, and then someday you'd leave me for somebody new. Worry, why do I let myself worry? What in the world did I do? I'm crazy for thinking that my love could hold you. I'm crazy for trying, I'm crazy for crying, and I'm crazy for loving you.
Thank you.
A lot of people are going to be heading back home for Thanksgiving, including ourselves. And here's a little song that Alice Gerard wrote I'd like to do with Willie Nelson here and Johnny and Pete, called You Gave Me a Song. We used to be a family in our little cabin home. The windows, they're all broken, and the chimney's dark and cold. Jobs were hard to find back then. It wasn't easy to survive. One by one, we all left home to change our way of life. Got a job up in the factory on that old assembly line. Gonna climb on up the hill and leave my past behind. But the only climbing that I did was five flights up the stairs. And the past I thought I'd left behind went with me everywhere. 'Cause you gave me a song of a place that I call home. A song of then, a song of now, a song of yet to come.
So here we are, my past and me, working in this bar. I sing a song of broken hills and streams that once ran clear. I sing a song of you, my friend, lonely just like me. The city's taken all we have but sweet, sad memories. But someday I'll go home again. Lord, it's been a long, hard road. I'm not saying that I'll stay, but I know now if I go, I'm gonna take you with me and what you gave when I was young. Others held me for a while, but you held me all along. Cause you gave me a song of a place that I call home. A song of then, a song of now, a song of yet to come. For you gave me a song of a place that I call home. A song of then, a song of now, a song of yet to come.
Now if this world from you withhold of its silver and its gold, and you have to get along with meager fare, just remember in God's word how he fed those little birds. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there.
Just leave it there.
Don't leave it there.
Leave it there.
Don't leave it there.
Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there.
If you will trust him and never doubt, he will surely bring you out.
Take your burdens to the Lord and leave it there.
If your body suffers pain and your health you can't regain, and your soul is almost sinking in despair, Jesus knows the pain you feel. He can save and he can heal. So take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Leave it there.
Oh, leave it there.
Just leave it there.
Please leave it there.
Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there.
If you will trust him and never doubt, he will surely bring you out.
And take your burden to the Lord and leave it there.
your youthful days are gone, and old age is stealing on, and your body bends beneath the weight of care. Jesus will never leave you then, he'll go with you to the end. Take your burden to the Lord,
or your body, either one, you both.
Leave it there,
oh, leave it there,
leave it there,
oh, leave it there.
Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. If you will trust him and never doubt, he will surely bring you out. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Now if your mother leaves you here, grief and sorrow you must bear, and you feel that all the friends you have are gone, and if you feel alone, Jesus will take you in his arms. So take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Just leave it there.
And leave it there.
Leave it there.
Just leave it there.
Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. If you will trust him and never doubt, he will surely bring you out. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Just leave it there.
Oh, leave it there.
Leave it there.
Yes, leave it there.
Take your burdens to the Lord and leave it there. If you trust him and never doubt, he will surely bring you out. And take your burdens to the Lord and leave it there. Take your burdens to the Lord and leave it there.
Blossoms waiting, poor butterfly, 'cause she loves him so. The moments turn into hours, the hours turn into years, and as she smiles through her tears, she murmurs low, I miss him so. The moon and I know that he'll be faithful, that he'll come to her by and by. But if he don't come back, then I'll never sigh or cry, I just must die. Poor butterfly. He'll come by and by. If he don't come back, then I'll never sigh or cry. I just must die. Poor butterfly.
Let's come in here with just a word from the oil rig, the dishwashing liquid for men who do their share around the house.
You know, cleaning the house and doing laundry and cooking the meals, it's not women's work and it's not men's work. It's just work that has to be done regardless of gender. But still, doing dishes used to be a problem for me because dishwashing detergent softened my hands and made them beautiful and attractive. And when I'd go to my Friday night bowling game, I had to wear rubber gloves so the guys wouldn't see how nice my hands looked. But then I discovered Oil Rig dishwashing liquid for men. I use it every day. It keeps my hands red, rough, and cracked. And I par ever hole, strike ever goal. And I love it, and my hands love it.
That was from the heart, folks. Oil Rig, the dishwashing liquid for men who do their share but don't want everybody to know about it necessarily.
In the twilight glow, I see her. In the rain, and when we kissed goodbye and parted, I knew that we'd never meet again. Through the ages, I'll remember blue eyes crying in the rain. Yonder, we'll stroll hand in hand again. In a land that knows no party,
right
guitar and mandolin. Tell me how much better could it be
to hear those sweet notes climbing up the spotlight to the sky, to see the dancers whisper as they sway.
Let me be there singing side by side with you when the band begins to play.
Thanks a lot, guys. It's been a quiet week in my hometown of Lake Wobegon. I guess, I don't know, I'm a long way away from there, and it's hard to keep track. They're secretive people. They don't tell me a lot over the phone. I had a hard time getting through, and in fact did not get through to them the last couple of days, which made me even a little bit more nervous. I get this far away from home, a couple thousand miles, and I stay away for a long time, and I start to wonder if it's a real place or if I made it up, if it's if maybe I would go into the airport tomorrow and I'd ask to go back to Minnesota and they'd look at me like I was crazy and they'd say, Minnesota, you didn't know? That's not a real state. That's a mythical state. Say, no, all my friends are there. My house is there. My family is there. The woman I love, when she comes over, she's going to meet me there. That's not mythical. And they'd look at me and smile, and they'd say, I know, it really seems real, doesn't it? It's the power of the imagination, they'd say. I'd say, no, I just want a ticket. And they'd say, really, believe us. Believe us. It's frightening because all those people, the people who love us, the people we love, they're all so amazing that when we get away from them and lose touch, we wonder if that all really happened, what we think happened in the past. The exiles be thinking about that, I'm sure, this week as they drive home with their little kids, driving north up through that landscape, no leaves on the trees, those bare ruined trees. Like Shakespeare wrote, that time of year thou mayest in Minnesota behold, when yellow leaves or none or few do hang upon those boughs that shake against the cold, bare ruined choirs where late the sweet birds sang. Was that all real, that part of Minnesota up there that Shakespeare wrote about? Was that all real, that life that we lived in that little town as we drive up through the brown fields over the hills and come up towards the grain elevator and the lake? Did that all happen? That life where we all lived in that little house, all of us kids, and we went to school and we played in the backyard and it got cold and the snow fell. Was that all real? All those little kids and all those little beds, and that Thanksgiving when we were all sick, all of us were sick to our stomachs and down in bed, and Mother was sick too, but she came around and took care of us, and we all had basins alongside our little beds and lay there looking pale and green, and she gave us Pepto-Bismol so that when we threw up it would be pink and smell nice. And we just lay there in bed throwing up for Thanksgiving. What a wonderful memory. Felt so sick, like we'd been on a 300-mile car trip in a car with the windows shut, squeezed in with four fat aunts, just sitting there feeling sicker and sicker was how we felt. And then, of course, the kids who were getting over it, they came around to the kids who were just getting into it.
and tried to make them sicker. Came upstairs and they'd bring us a big glass of tomato juice and they'd say, here, have some nice warm blood. This is good. Just got this, collected this from your cat. Brought us a little piece of lemon meringue pie, just the meringue part. They said, here, have some real nice green pus. Would you like some? Some crushed walnuts. Here, have put this on the green pus. Fresh boogers, boogers. Little children lying in bed, sick, sick to their stomachs for Thanksgiving. Then on Thanksgiving Day, the neighbor came by, bring us a little dinner, and thought we wouldn't be up for a real turkey dinner, so brought us turkey a la king. It was kind of chunky and kind of yellowish. There was a lot of starch in it. She made it with some kind of brownish, greenish soup or something. I just poured Pepto-Bismol on mine and put it directly in the basin. Skip the middleman. Was that all true? Did that all really happen? And if that really was us, then how did we ever become so distinguished? All those little children from that Thanksgiving that seems so recent, how did we all get so old and have children who are now about to have children of their own? How did that happen? Well, there'd be a lot of distinguished children coming back for Thanksgiving, and also a mysterious stranger, Senator Kay Torvaldsen's lady love, flying out from the state of Maine to see him, whom he met down in Florida last winter, Senator Kay Torvaldsen, and his great love, Laura, who's coming to have Thanksgiving dinner for them. He doesn't dare go pick her up at the airport. Byron is going to drive down and get her, because he's so in love, he's afraid of driving a car, afraid he could be just driving along an open road, perfectly dry, clear, bright, sunny day, and the car just suddenly flip over and would just flip like that. That's how much in love he is. The car driving along on a flat stretch of open highway, dry pavement, could just flip over like that. He's in love and starting to worry that when that handsome, gray-haired, slender lady with a sweet voice that he's talked to on the telephone so many times, when she comes and meets his family, will she find out things about him that will make her love him less? When he meets them all and sits down, when she does, with his relatives who sit furious eaters, serious, determined, fierce eaters, guarding their plates with their left forearm around the table, shoveling with the right hand, watching the chow supply out of the corner of their eye as the bowls go by and the platters of meat, checking to make sure there's still stuff left. And his brother Knut sitting there at the table with his three jokes that he always brings every holiday dinner. Three is about all he can commit to memory, and he's got to get in all three of them in the course of a dinner. He doesn't need a cue or anything. He doesn't need to be reminded of them. Just a moment of silence is enough. And he'll say, so, there was the one about the Norwegian and the Swede without the parachute on the airplane. No, it was a Swede. I thought, no. I think there was a Finn, too, or maybe he was the pilot. Anyway, the plane was in trouble, so that was why they needed the parachute. And they were all drunk at the time, and I forgot to tell you, they were flying to Norway. And they were over the ocean anyway. And he tells his joke, and there is a moment of silence at the end of it. Strange, strange family. What will she think? What will she think of them? and Knut's wife Birdie, who reads too much and remembers all the worst part of it, all the bad news. Birdie remembers, stores up, keeps in her memory. Doesn't need any cue, just a moment of silence, and Birdie will tell you something you'd rather not know about. Some study she read about sunshine and having to do with cancer and some things that they don't even want the American people to know about for fear that people would never go out in the sun if they knew it. She's read this. Bombs, thousands of bombs sitting in lockers in airports. Thousands of them. Left there over the years by terrorists. They didn't go off. Anything could set those bombs off at any time. The vibration of engines from mighty jets, they could just go off and you'd never know it. She heard this from a girlfriend of hers whose brother-in-law is a policeman. They don't tell people about this because they know people would never fly again if they knew about it. Bombs in suitcase lockers, just sitting there. Sitting there like a ticking time bomb. Stuff in food. Additives, chemicals they put in there, pesticides, stuff that combines with other stuff, and some virus type, amoeba type stuff, algae and things in your food that you can't even see that's lying there, that if you looked at your food through a microscope, you wouldn't be able to eat. And that's why they don't tell people about this, is that it would make you sick if you saw it. Forks pausing in midair. That's Birdie, and that's Knut, and his love will meet them all when she comes on Wednesday. Oh, he's so in love, though. He's so in love. That old man, he stops down to the sidetrack tap every day and sits at the bar and talks to Wally and walks over to the jukebox and says, "Boy, you just don't have the good songs on this jukebox that you used to have, Wally. This jukebox, you've let this jukebox just go downhill. I don't know. There's nothing here that I really care about anymore. All the songs I liked, you took off this jukebox. But I suppose I'll play something." And always puts in his quarter and always plays one song after complaining about it. "Wise men say only fools rush in, but I can't help falling in love with you." And goes to the window, that old man, as Elvis's voice washes around the inside of the sidetrack tap. "Should I stay, would it be a sin if I can't help falling in love with you?" She comes on Wednesday. Love stories in Lake Wobegon, it's the only stories I'm aware of up there. Lyle, he's not smoked now in 8 months. Amazing. Hasn't smoked, hasn't bothered him. He's noticed some changes. After a few months, oxygen started to get to his brain. He started to have ideas. He used to think he'd give up biology teaching and maybe go into taxidermy. He was thinking about taking a mail order course in taxidermy and do some of this taxidermy where you make little tableaus using small animals. Like you take a bunch of squirrels and you set them, you stuff them, you set them in poses, you dress them in little clothes around a table playing poker or something. Or stuff a bunch of cats at a wedding. You have little cat weddings. Take a bunch of little dogs and stuff and pose them as stockbrokers, put suits on and stuff. Bars, taverns pay good money for this sort of thing. He was thinking about taxidermy as maybe a career for himself. And now he's been thinking he's going to stay in biology teaching, that he really likes it. And he's been thinking that maybe he and Janice ought to have another baby. one more baby. It's been 11 years since the last one. One last child, a little girl. He can almost imagine her. A little girl. He's been thinking about that for months. He'd like to have one more. Stories of Love, Ella Anderson. A couple weeks ago, sitting at a card table in her kitchen, old, old woman with arthritis, married to Henry, the oldest man in town, 86, and as they say, he has his good days. And this was not one of them. He was a long way away and many years in the past, sitting there. She was working on a puzzle, a 1,000-piece jigsaw puzzle that her daughter Charlotte had sent to her, and it had taken her days to even get going on it. It was a lawn, and it was rose bushes, and there was a grape arbor and a swing. And she looked at the jigsaw puzzle, Ella Anderson, and it reminded her of something that happened 60-some years ago, when the summer before they were engaged, she walked to Henry's house and looked over the bushes, and he was kissing a girl named Doris. 60-some years ago, but the sight of this grape arbor brought it all back to her. The pain, the shame, her face burned. She looked at him sitting there, 86-year-old man. He looked as if he was having a good time somewhere and was murmuring to somebody. And that was Ella's first thought, was that he was with Doris. That he thought he was with Doris. She broke into tears. 60-some years later, still jealous. That's love. Mm. Well, it's all I can think of. It's all I can think of. How much should I tell you? How much have I told you? Probably told you a lot more than I thought, huh? Well, I sit around thinking about her all the time. And thinking back to when I met her again this summer. And we talked and we said goodbye. And she walked away. And I watched her go, and without meaning to, I followed her. And I started running, and I caught up with her, and I took her hand, and I looked at her, and she was laughing. And I never turned around. Is she real? I hope so. I hope she's not a story that I made up. Thinking about her this morning, lying in bed and trying to get my thoughts on the right track, I reached into the drawer of the bedstand and found the Gideon's Bible. And I was going for the Psalms, friend. Honest, I was. But I found the Song of Solomon instead. It was back there in the Bible. It's back there. Rise up, my love, and come away, for lo, the winter is past, the rains are over and gone, and lots more terrific verses. I put some of them into a song here. This is a song we did on the show, and people sang with me a few weeks ago, an old spiritual called My Father, How Long. Try it with me. You'll pick this up. I want to hear you sing in this big, dark auditorium. I bet you got sweet voices. If we find our chord, we'll sing this song from the Song of Solomon. And because it's dark in this room, you won't be embarrassed. My Father, how long? My Father, how long? My Father, how long? This poor sinner suffer here. That's the tune. Oh, how pleasant and how fair. How pleasant and how fair. Oh, how pleasant and how fair my beloved is to me. You are beautiful, my love. You're beautiful, my love. You are beautiful, my love. So pleasant and so fair. And it won't be It won't be long, and it won't be long. This poor sinner suffer here. Your eyes are like a dove's. Your eyes are like a dove's. Your eyes are like a dove's. And your hair a flock of goats. And your hair a flock of goats. Your hair a flock of goats. And your hair a flock of goats. Your eyes are like a dove's. Your neck a mighty tower. Your neck a mighty tower. Your neck a mighty tower. And your teeth a flock of sheep. And your teeth a flock of sheep.
She's some woman.
Your teeth a flock of sheep. And your teeth a flock of sheep. And your neck a mighty tower. Your breasts are too shy, dear. Your breasts are too shy, dear. Your breasts are too shy, dear. That feed among the flowers. 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 Your breasts are too shy, dear. Oh, where is my love gone? Oh, beloved is to me. shoulders once more and think about somebody. Oh, how pleasant and how fair. How pleasant and how fair. Oh, how pleasant and how fair. My beloved is to me. That's the news from Lake Wobegon.
All the women are strong. All the men are good looking. All the children are above.